Okay, welcome back. Linux terminal commands. I'm going to continue that. There is small break. I give some simple examples how Linux is similar to Android and what are dissimilarities. What is kernel? Core of the operating system. It manages all the hardware, processes, memory, jobs, etc., etc. So the core kernel is same in both of the cases. That means Android also uses same Linux kernel, and Linux of course uses the Linux kernel. And any one of you know that recently only the Linux kernel and Android kernel, they got merged. What happened earlier, Android people, they forked Linux kernel tree. You understand forking? Yes, forking means they got a branch from Linux kernel tree. Tree means source code. And they build their own drivers, set of whatever optimization, whatever they did. And Linux people, they didn't accepted those changes immediately, but very recently it got resolved. So when you download source from kernel.org, you get source for both Android and Linux kernel. Of course, Android kernel is also Linux kernel, but as this is a fork and it was not officially the part of the Linux kernel, things got resolved and now we have a single source tar file download from kernel.org, and you can optimize it for either for your telephone, mobile phone, or for your desktop environment. Both are compatible with GNU applications. So what is GNU? See, in 1983, I think, Richard S. Stallman, he got source code from Unix source. There was some license by which you can take source from Unix, similar to your Mac, Apple. It also forked from basic Unix operating system's source code, and it created, as it was a BSD licensed source code, so you can easily fork your source code, and he can create a independent distribution from that source code, and he may close the source also. Means with BSD license, how BSD license work, you can have the open source components with you, you can compile it, and you may not release the source code again. And what is GNU license? GNU license says that if you are downloading source and if you are compiling and if you are redistributing the binary, you have to give a copy of that source to the user. This was GNU says. And what does BSD license. BSD license is completely more open and it's more industry supported license. What it says, if you download source code, okay, no problem. If you compile it and use the binary for your purpose, okay with that. If you don't want to release the modifications you did in the previous code, source code which you have downloaded, it's okay. So Apple did like that. It used the BSD license, it exploited it, not exploited, it's, sorry, it's not exploited, it used the open source thing. It built its own components, added some components. If you ever visit opensource.apple.com, you can see the list of open source packages which Apple uses in its operating system. Just if you get time sometime, just visit the site opensource.apple.com, you will find all the applications there. So in a way, you can say Apple is also Unix based, but though it's a big development chain it followed, so now it become little bit different from basic Unix thing. But if you run MacBook ever, you will see your all the commands, bash, etc., etc., everything works there without any modification. Okay, that was not the part of the discussion. Licensing. So GPL force you to have open source license, means if you are using, you have to give the source code, and if you are redistributing, then also you have to redistribute the source. So Richard S. Stallman, he proposed the GNU license, called GNU GPL license. And GNU is the set of softwares, applications. So at 1989, I think, I'm not sure about the date, he started writing a kernel. Who started? Richard S. Stallman started writing a kernel. But by the time he was able to deliver the kernel, before that, Linus Torvalds has already released his kernel as open source, and he named his kernel as Linux. So the applications were already built, like Emacs or some core utilities like LS, CP. They are known as core utilities. They were already there in GNU licensing. So what Richard Stallman did, he contacted with Linus Torvalds, and they named the operating system as GNU Linux. So wherever you see official documentation, people don't say Linux, they say GNU Linux, because GNU is the set of softwares and Linux is the core operating system. Okay. So both are compatible to GNU applications. Means I will show you the demo of Android tablet just after 5-10 minutes. You can see LS, CP, those things, they are also work. Though you have to install it, but it supports GNU applications. Okay, these are the similarities. So users and permissions. So there also you can have users, groups and others, same thing. File system of latest version of Android, same as Linux. Excuse me. If you are using Android 4.0, that is ICS, Ice Cream Sandwich, the file system recommended for Ice Cream Sandwich is ext4, extension 4 file system, which is very common and popular file system for Linux desktop environments. If you have ever formatted your machine and installed Ubuntu or any operating system, it will ask for by which file system you want to format the device. If you can select from ext2, ext3, ext4, YAFS2, different file systems are there. So file system are also compatible with Android and Linux from present version. What are the dissimilarities? This is important, and this is why we are trying to port many applications to Android. If it is completely compatible, we could have ported immediately. Problem is, the Android operating system uses a stripped down version of libc. You all understand libc? Libc is a library of libc is a C library. Okay, so if you download bare minimal operating systems, see Ubuntu distribution is available for 50 MB distro also. If you browse your Ubuntu site in CD images, you find what is a minimal installation image, that is 50 MB image is also there. Means you download Ubuntu.iso for 50 MB, it's called net installed. You should have your Ethernet cable plugged in, and you can download the rest of operating system from internet. But in that 50 MB also, the main component is libc, glibc, because whatever core operating system utilities are there, they all compiled in C. They are C code basically. Almost all of the Linux kernel is written in C. So to run any C program, you need some library support. There are two ways to compile a C program. Just we have seen, I did cc space hello.c, it gave me a.out. So let me, is there? Yeah. So I want to know what kind of file this is, a.out. So file space a.out will tell me the details of that file. So it says elf64 lsb executable, but it's dynamically linked, uses shared libs. What does it mean? That means it uses glibc for information, for libraries. I can compile this hello.c. I think my hello.c is in home directory. Yeah, I can compile this hello.c by giving a flag known as hyphen static. By default, it will create a.out. Suppose I want to name my output file, let me give it hello. Now, if you see file hello, it will say statically linked. Okay. Why I am showing this? Because if you build all your applications statically, it will contain your library information, whatever stdio.h or printf function we used, the information is kept inside my binary itself. If you see the size of this ls-lh hello, for the same code it is 859k. Okay, ls-lh today a.out it is 8.2k. Why this difference? Because this a dot out uses shared libraries and my hello binary uses statically linked libraries. So, due to this size constraint, what we do? We ship the library files by default with any operating systems. So, whatever source code you have, suppose ls is not statically bind, statically compiled. It is dynamically compiled. To use ls, you need libc. Are you getting? So, for the 50 MB distro also or 25 MB distro also, minimum requirement is glibc. That should be present there. But in Android environment, we do not have glibc. Why? Because probably in glibc, we have lot of extra stuff which is not required for mobile phone, tablet. Probably because that glibc which we are talking about, means desktop glibc, it contains many default libraries which are frequently used for desktop applications. But for mobile phone, which is a single user small scale device, we do not need those libraries. So, what did Google and Android community did? They created a stripped down version of same glibc, okay, and they name it as Bionic Libc. So, what is the difference now, glibc and Bionic Libc? Whatever, suppose I compile this hello, though this is compiled for x64 based device, is not it? I mean, for this laptop it is compiled. I have a cross compiler installed in my machine. You understand the concept of cross compiler? No. Cross compiler is a compiler by which we can compile from this native machine, host machine, for any other architecture. So, this is an 64 bit architecture machine. We have 32 bit Intel processors, we have 64 bit AMD processors, we have Power PC processors, we have AVR processors, different processors we have. Similarly, we have ARM processors. Okay. So, in most of the mobile phone devices or small scale devices, tablet devices, ARM processors are very popular. And ARM processors, they have a family name, like we have Core 2 Duo, Core i3, Core i5, Core i7. Similarly, in the ARM scenario, we say as ARM version 5, ARM version 6, ARM version 7. Okay. Unlike your x86 system, that is Core 2 Duo, Core i3, Core i7, where binary is compatible. If I compile this binary, means this I compiled for 64 bit machine and this is Core i3 machine. If I run this same binary in my Core 2 Duo machine, which is also a dual core machine, 64 bit machine, it will work. But in ARM based devices, the development is not like that. So, if you compile something in ARM version 7, it is not backward compatible. So, if you compile a dot out for ARM version 7, that will work for ARM version 7 and above. It won't work in ARM version 6, ARM version 5, ARM version 4, like that. Okay. Fine. So, the major difference is the version of C library is different, and this is only creating a big problem for us. Suppose I want to port Scilab on this tablet. What I have to do? I have to compile entire Scilab code for Bionic Libc based ARM processor, not glibc based. If I compile it for glibc based, that will work on any other ARM device which does not have Bionic Libc, which has glibc. Have you ever seen BeagleBoard? No embedded knowledge. Okay. So, BeagleBoard is a development board and it has similar processor, ARM Cortex A8. So, as you already know, the present version of Akash tablet will have ARM version A8 processor, ARM Cortex A8 processor, which is ARM family 7 processors, version 7 family processors. So, the speed of the processor is 800 megahertz. It can be increased software by software means also, that is not important. So, whatever you compile in ARM version 7, it will work in only ARM version 7. And I am talking about tablet. This tablet has Android operating system, that means Bionic Libc. Libc, which it uses, is Bionic Libc. Android uses Bionic Libc. But I can run ARM Cortex A8, I can run full Ubuntu version on ARM Cortex A8 also. Are you getting what I'm trying to make a point? See, there are some development boards. Have you seen 8051 development board or 8085 development board in your lab? No. There are processor boards, development boards, on which there are some input output ports. You can connect it to monitor, you can connect it to keyboard. There is an SD card similar to hard disk. There are procedures given in internet. You can download even in Ubuntu website. You get an image for ARM Cortex A8 Beagle board. Just download that image, copy to SD card, follow the steps. There are some steps to follow. Start the machine. Your Ubuntu will run from your ARM Cortex A8 development board. Okay, but that Ubuntu has ARM version of glibc. ARM version of glibc, that is different from your tablets, because your tablet is same processor, but it has Bionic Libc instead of glibc. I hope I made my point. In any Linux environment, whatever I am running is an X server running in the backend. I can install a bare minimal Linux distro with no X also. That means it will have only consoles, Control Alt F1, Control Alt F2. It will give you a console ports. Okay. In older days, we used to communicate, means there are only consoles, there were no X environment. So, in console, you can type your commands, Linux commands, of course, but there will be no graphical output. And this terminal is an emulator. You understand emulator? So, it emulates the console. So, whatever commands you can type in Control Alt F1, I can't do Control Alt F1, I think the monitor won't support, sorry, projector won't support, but you can try that later. So, yeah, what I am trying to say is X server is important. In any Linux desktop distribution or development board, ARM Cortex A8 distribution, you can install an X server. I think this user bin X. So, X is a program, it is a server. Server means serves. So, whatever, so I have different windows here. Like this is one terminal, this is one browser, this is a Chromium browser. Okay. So, my X manages all this. But in Android, you don't have any X environment. That's one of the difference. Android runs on Dalvik virtual machine. You heard of Dalvik? Okay. If you heard of Android, you probably heard of Dalvik. Dalvik is a process virtual machine. What it does, it runs .dex files, which are executable, and they are compiled from native Java files. Okay. So, what is there? There is a Linux kernel. There is an interaction frame buffer layer. There is a Dalvik virtual machine running over the kernel, and all your UIs are communicated through this Dalvik only. You have touch screen, different layers are there. Of course, I am not going in that detail. So, there is no X server running in your tablet or mobile phone. Okay, that is the difference. Native Linux UI apps, user interface apps, they won't work in tablet or your Android phone. Why? Because there is no X server. You can install an X server in probably in Android, but that's the other thing, because X server consumes lot of memory, and in tablet or phone based distros, we don't have that much memory. So, native Linux UI apps can't be ported Android directly, and there are some other changes also. Now, this is a tablet. This is very similar to Akash tablet. I have it, actually I don't have it with me. So, it has same processor ARM Cortex A8, which the proposed version of Akash has, and it is installed, it has Ice Cream Sandwich running. Ice Cream Sandwich means Android 4.0, it is the latest Android operating system. So, I have connected this through an USB. So, what I can do is, before that I want to show you some development. If you go to this site, developer.android.com. Actually, I'm running this site locally. I don't have internet here. So if you search for search in internet about Android source code or Android SDK, you will get the first link on the same site. So SDK, what is SDK? Software Development Kit. And what it does, it helps you to write code for Android phone or tablet, and it helps you to debug phone or tablet also. Debugging is important because you can write code in Eclipse IDE. How many of you used Eclipse before? Good. Anyway, I'm not covering Eclipse in this part. So installing SDK is very simple. All you have to do is you have to download source. There will be a, if you see, you can download source from, you can download SDK from a link. I have to locate that link. I don't want to waste time with that. I have already downloaded, so I can show you how it looks. So we can go through the file browser only. So I will go to Srikanth, documents, Android SDK. So I downloaded a tar file, tar.gz. I untarred it using command line or graphical, and I got these many folders and different things. So there is no Eclipse folder here. So by default, when you download Android SDK, you don't get Eclipse with it. You have to download Eclipse and Sun JDK separately, and you have to put it in a path. Everything is well documented. There are tens and thousands of tutorials on internet and YouTube. You won't be alone for this purpose. So there are some directories which have some significance that you can get it from here. So basic environments are SDK tools, SDK platform tools, and SDK platform. So they contains the platform information, means what platform you are using. And of course, we'll see these things later. Yeah. So coming back to terminal, let me go to document Android SDK. So I have these many folders. Let me see the size of this du-sh Android SDK. I think I downloaded a 100 MB tar file, and after uncompressing it becomes around, guess, 400 MB. The time it's taking, it's embarrassing, it's 2.5 GB. Okay, because I created many Android virtual devices, and probably I copied some image files inside this during development, so size increased, but it's not 2.5 GB when you untar it. So first thing to start with is, what is an SDK and why Android is free? Yeah, what does Google do actually? How Google earn? Through advertisements. So if it has an operating system, it can easily control the advertisements on one's phone, and based on your search terms in phone or in desktop, by default you are logged in whenever you search. So Google maintains a complete history of you, complete profile of your search, and it gives you a customized ads for that. If you are searching for flights from Mumbai to Delhi for say last week, for next 1 month probably you will get advertisements from different sites which provides ticketing for flights, like that. So phone is an integral part of everyone's life now. So people stick to phone more than their laptop or desktops. So if you are using Android, you probably have seen ads in Android if you are connected to internet. So by default, except core apps like Gmail or Gmail and Google Talk, in all other apps you get ads, and you can't control them. You can't make, like in YouTube, if you get an ad, you can close that ad. Now they have enforce the ads also in YouTube, that you have to wait 30 seconds or 4 seconds to skip the ad, etc., etc. But during the video, whatever pop-up ad you get, you can close that, isn't it? But In phone, you can't do that. They enforce the ad completely, and that's how they earn. That's why they created Android operating system. And of course, there is quite a bit of competition, and Google or any other company, it's a partnership actually. Google, LG, China Phone, Samsung, many companies have came together to build Android. And it's very competitive world, because Google is coming into TV industry also. So you have Google TV. Similarly, we have Apple TV. And Google and Apple, they are always rival. So whatever, see, Google can't hire tens and millions, tens and thousands of developers to write code. So what it does, it made it open source. So people like you and me will code for Google, and we'll make apps, and Google will push ads in those apps, and everyone is happy. What I did, I just connected this tablet to my laptop, and I'm going to access this phone from laptop, this tablet from laptop. For that, SDK is enough. So I downloaded SDK, I'm in SDK directory. Actually, if you have seen my bash.rc file, I have already set the path for Android SDK somewhere. See, export path to $path, home, Srikanth, document, Android SDK, tools. So in tools, I have binaries for SDK and Android SDK platform tools. In these two locations, I have my binaries. Okay, you want to see, you can just copy this and you can just cd to that. So all whatever you see in green are binaries. So there is a binary known as ADB, Android. We'll see each one of them. So let's start with Android. What is Android? As path is set, phone is connected. I want to disconnect phone for a while to just demo you something. So when I hit enter, it gives a graphical output finally. And in this graphical output, I have different options. See, it says extras are installed, Android 2.2 API is installed. Okay, so Google releases APIs for each development release. So if you remember, from 1 to 1.5, Google Android 1.6, then it came 2.1 Eclair, 2.2 Froyo, 2.3 Gingerbread, 3.0 Honeycomb, Ice Cream Sandwich. And 5.0 is Jelly Beans. So, yeah, Jelly Beans. Android, so I have installed latest API for this SDK, which is Android 4.0.3 API 15. In tools, I have AVD, Android Virtual Device Manager. So, manage AVDs, sorry. I think I have to go to. So Android Virtual Device Manager. So these are my test emulators. So I have written some code and I have to test it on phone or tablet, and my tablet is not around. I don't want to connect my tablet every time. Suppose I'm in lab and I don't have tablet, my tablet is in my hostel or home, wherever. How would I program then? I can use an emulator in that case. Of course, it is recommended to use on emulator first, then on tablet or your device. So you can, let me show you how to create a new AVD. So let me delete one, I don't have space in my home. So let me make it full screen. Is it visible? No. So let me remove this temp so that I can make some space. It's deleted. Now let me create a new one. So what I am creating here is important. This is a emulator, a virtual device I am creating. Why I need this virtual device? To run my applications. Any Android software comes with extension .apk. Like in Windows we have .exe, in Ubuntu we have .deb. For Android we have .apk. Okay. So give anything like Now, when I hit target, I have these many options. Say I choose Android 2.3 or Android 2.2, old one, but no problem. I can create a SD card also. Suppose let me create a 100 MB SD card. Snapshot will save your particular state of the virtual machine for further development. Suppose you are doing some development and you have to stop the development in between, you can take the snapshot of that version of development, and when next time you run it, it will start from there. Okay, this is important when you are doing some important stuff. So this is the resolution you can set: QVGA, HVGA. These are the terms. So QVGA is 320 into 240. So this WVGA is 800 into 480 resolution, etc., etc. That's it. Create AVD. It says result of creating AVD is successful with following hardware configurations. This. So I can see my Srikanth AVD here. What I can do is I can start it immediately. So it pop up some launch options. You want to scale the device? No, I don't want to scale it now. Launch. So it will pop up a window which will emulate as a phone. So I have not connected my device now. I will show what is the difference between this and that. We will just copy one APK to here and to virtual device also, and we'll see the difference. It will take some time to boot. Meanwhile, we'll explore some other possible commands. So we have seen Android. There is another command known as ADB. What is ADB? Android Debug Bridge. This command allows you to connect your device from your desktop. Why you need to connect? Maybe you want to change some system permissions in your phone. Maybe you want to execute some command inside your phone. Maybe you want to wipe out complete Dalvik cache. Many things you may, because if you are a system designer for Android, you probably need many things to work around. So ADB will allow you to connect to device, and ADB will also help you to reinstall your phone software. But that is not available for all the phones and devices, because most of the devices comes with factory locked, means vendor locked. So suppose you are using Samsung or LG phone, it comes by default, the bootloader is by default locked by the vendor. So you can unlock the bootloader and you can install custom ROMs. Probably this is going into much detail. What do you mean by custom ROMs? See, Android is an open source project. So I can also download a source. Of course, I have downloaded source. I will show you the Android source now. So cd/stuff/home/cd/android. So this is my Android source. This is my Android directory. Inside that is a system directory. du-sh dot means tell me the size of this directory. This will around, I don't want to guess. It should be around 11 GB. Let's see. Okay. So meanwhile, let's see our AVD. Yeah, it's booted. So I have full functioning mobile phone on my system itself, which is capable of running all the general functionality except of calls and SMS. Of course, we are not connected to network. So I can play around with it, but this is not the purpose. Okay, it's 11 GB. This time I am right. So you have to download. Yeah, as I told you, Android is an open source project. You can download a copy of Android. You can compile the Android source and you can create your own operating system. That is very easy. It looks 11 GB of source. Oh my God, it will take a lot of time. Of course, it will take a lot of time. It will have some dependency issues also. But once it's resolved, you can make frequent builds and you can test lot of customization. You can do lot of customization on your Android phone. So there is a very famous customized version of Android known as Cyanogen mode. Okay, so Cyanogen mode is also open source. They have changed it from the original Android source. They added some extra features. So original Android phone, as you can see, doesn't have many options. Like, you don't have a graphical equalizer, you don't have Intigino browser, many features means you can't install themes by default. But the Cyanogen mode provides you the extra functionality. So from where we started, yeah, this is there, this is the Android source. Now I was telling you about the ADB command. Now my phone is booted. ADB command is Android debug bridge. First we have seen Android command, what it does, it allows you to download the latest API, and it allows you to create a emulator. That part is done. Now I have a second and most important command. There are many other commands, but they are not relevant for us. This is sufficient enough, ADB. Just type ADB and hit enter. It will list lot of options. Don't try all these options on your phone. So most important options I will list out, like ADB devices. What it will show? It will show list of devices connected with this computer. So it says there is an emulated device running on port 5554 is there. Now I can type ADB shell. What it will do? It will give me access to that device. It will just send me inside that device, ADB shell. So it give me a hash prompt. Why hash prompt? Because I am not in bash environment anymore. So this was a bash environment which was giving me the proper complete home path, username, @, host name, etcetera, etcetera. But now I am in this phone, I am inside this phone. My prompt signifies that, hash prompt signifies that I am inside this phone, and this hash signifies something else also. What else? By default, you probably have seen the prompt is $, means it is a user prompt. If I do, I get a hash prompt. Su means super user. So I am root now. So when I did ADB shell, I got a hash prompt. That means I am a root user for this phone. That means this phone is already rooted. In general Android term, they spell it as rooted phone, rooted device. If you search in internet, just like rooted, you get a lot of suggestions, rooted Android, rooted Nuke phone, this, etcetera, etcetera. But this is not the general case. As this is an emulator, so Google allows you to play around with this emulator, so it gave you hash prompt. But with default phones, whatever you buy from market, if you connect it and do ADB shell, you will get a $ prompt. That means you are not super user, you are a user, some user. Are you getting? Even with the tablet, if I connect the tablet, this tablet is rooted tablet, so when I connect it, it will show the hash prompt as it is a rooted tablet. Otherwise, it will show a $ prompt, that means you are a user. If you get a $ prompt in ADB shell, you can't do anything. Means you can do things, but you can't change system properties, you can't set the path variables, you can't mount, many things, many restrictions you have. Okay, enough talking. LS works. So out of the box, LS works. That means my Bionic Libc has my LS command is compiled for Bionic Libc. Okay, LS is a core util, GNU program. Okay, so is there a which is not there? So many commands won't be there, like touch. Is touch is there? Tab completion also doesn't work, because this is a shell prompt. It's not bash. Bash is born again shell, which is an advanced shell environment, and this is a sh. So is touch is there? Touch is not there. Sorry. Clear also not works. What can I do? I can Okay. So I have restrictions. I don't have complete command set to work around with this. What I want to show is this. Similarly, let me show you another terminal. So this is the file hierarchy of my Android phone emulator, which I have run through Android command, and this is the file hierarchy of my desktop machine, Linux machine. Just ignore these files, these are created by myself, but by default bin, boot, chroot is also created by myself, dev, etc, home, these are the default files available in file system. If you compare, do you see the same file hierarchy here? You have config, cache, account, only MNT is there. MNT is also in Linux environment. If you see, you have MNT. What else you find? Do we have system here? No, no system. Sys, bin, sbin, this is my Linux machine, means desktop, this is my phone. I am just switching the windows very fast, don't confuse. So this is my phone, and it doesn't have similar file structure as that of my desktop machine. So by this you can see the level of optimization or customization Android people have done. They removed many unnecessary stuff which is not required for mobile phone, and they made it everything compatible to phone for single user machine. Now the important thing is system and data. At least for now, we will concentrate on these two things. What is system and what is data? Unlike Linux desktop, which has all the files under slash partitions, important files, system bin files, we have in Android all the important system files and folders, they are inside slash system. So if I go cd system and ls hyphen l, let me clear it, ls slash system. So my system has user, app, lib, etc, xbin, bin, media, fonts, and this is very similar to this. Can you see the similarity? I have bin, I have etc, I have lib, I have user, isn't it, in slash system. So Android stores every system information, system based files inside the slash system partition. So inside the user, you will have some binaries, user binaries. So you want to see ls slash system slash bin. So these are the binaries, like rm you recognize, mount, we have seen mount, and some other binaries. So slash system partition, normally no user has permission to read write inside that, unless it's rooted phone, rooted device. Rooted means you have a root permissions, you can do anything what you want. But slash data is system partition. So ls slash data, if you do, it has user level permissions, similar to, you can say, similar to your home partition. Whatever you saw on my laptop slash home slash Srikant, this is similar to that, but you don't have those directories here, but the permissions are similar. Even if the vendor want, he can lock this device also, means this directory also, means you can't create directory here, you can't copy files here, he can do anything, but by default you have permissions here. Okay, so here also you can see there is a folder app. So ls slash data slash app will list all the APKs. What are APKs? APKs are executables, means these are the packages which Android recognizes and it installs these packages. Unlike other packages like in Windows or Ubuntu desktop, we have .exe and .dev. When you install it, after installation you do not need the packages, is not it? Suppose you have installed a .dev file or .exe file, after installation you can remove the .exe file. But Android is different. For Android, if you install .apk, it will read from APK itself. Of course, it will create some temporary files and other files and folders, but it needs .apk also to run. If I remove all the APKs here, my phone will not, my all the apps in my phone will gone. Are you getting? So, why I want to show all this, because sometime later if you want to program or if you want to do system level changes in Android, you can come to this folder, you can release your app, you can remove your app, you can add something, you can create a directory, you can write a shell script which will automatically detect that, okay, if your data folder is actually you have similar apps in Android market which will copy all your APKs to SD card or some external media, but you can write your custom programs here. Fine. So, this is about Android ADB shell. So, ADB has some other options also, like you can directly install from your device. Suppose I have an APK here, I can directly install from this ADB command to my phone. Let me show you how. So, let me go to the directory where I have the APK. So, I have APK in. So, you can see there is an APK known as Android VNC dot something something APK. Okay. I can directly install that APK in my phone also. I just have to download and I have to click on that APK, it will install automatically. Just because I have created this APK using my some third party software and I want to test this APK right away in the Android virtual device, what I will do, I will just ADB install Android this, and this will install this APK to the default AVD connected. So, default AVD is connected what? This one. So, when I hit enter, so it says package goes to data local temp and success. So, it installed. So, I did not go inside the phone and inside the SD card or Android market to install the APK, I installed from here. Now, I want to see whether this APK is actually installed or not. So, that APK name was Android VNC. So, you can see Android VNC is here. Okay. Similarly, you can uninstall also, and you can copy files to your AVD, means this Android device. We have created 100 MB SD card, if you remember. So, what I can do is, I can go to ADB shell and I want to verify whether SD card is there or not. It's there. So, ls, let me go inside SD cards. What is there? Only one directory, that is lost dot, it is created default by Android. So, only one directory. I can copy files to my SD card directly from my host machine. How? ADB push. This will push my file to my phone SD card or phone data folder, wherever I want, depending upon permission. By default, any user will have at least permission to copy into SD card. So, ADB push, what file I have, same APK file I am pushing there to where slash SD card. Okay. So, I have to give the absolute path slash mount slash SD card. Actually, the problem is not that, problem was, I have to give a trailing slash also. So, it says that copy inside the SD card directory, otherwise it will replace the SD card, and SD card is a directory. So, it copied the file, you want to verify it, yes, what you have to do, you have to go, actually I do not have any file browser here, otherwise I could have shown you. API demos, let me see. I do not have a file browser. I can show you that ADB shell. I can go inside my phone cd, sd card. So my file is here. Suppose during development you probably need many files to copy paste, or you want to get some file from Android phone so as to analyze better. Suppose I want to copy entire slash data folder to my local machine, so that I want to check where I can tweak the changes so that I will get a result. What I will do? ADB pull from where? Slash data, say I have an app folder there, if you remember, to present working directory. So it's probably pulling all the apps. So probably that apk directory doesn't have apps apk, so it pulls some files. Probably I have given the wrong path. If you give the correct path, it will put all the files in that directory. Okay. Oh, so it copied this apk also, cube live wallpapers. It copied this apk, api demos apk it copied. Other than these apks, we have some files that also it copied from the same location. So what I mean to say is, you can copy files from your machine to your device. Reverse is also possible. You can install packages, apk files. You can uninstall packages. You can restart the phone from ADB itself. ADB reboot will reboot the phone. Probably this is an emulator. I don't think it will work. So you have lot more options with ADB. Suppose you want to install a new version of operating system. You are a developer. You are not an end user. You are a developer, and you want to create a, you want to give an update for your operating system. Suppose you are given a phone with 2.3 Android, and there is an update of Android 3.0. So first you will test it on emulator, then on real device, then you will release it in the market and ask people to download the latest operating system so that they can update. So what you can do is, you can there are options like ADB reboot bootloader. So this will reboot the device into a bootloader mode, where you can put something in your SD card, some image file in SD card. It will detect the default is SD card only. It will detect the SD card and it will install from the SD card. So it's like OS update. Are you getting? Suppose you have an Ubuntu distribution, you want to update to some other version of Ubuntu. What you do? You mainly either you do an update, or you uninstall the operating system and install a fresh copy of operating system. In phone's case, in tablet's case, what we do exactly is, the data portion is the user portion, slash data. As I told you, slash data is a user portion. So user data you don't have to touch. What you have to change is slash system only. Are you getting? So if you download an image of slash system and you reboot your phone, and instead of slash system image, you replace with the new slash system image, that will serve your purpose. Are you getting? So by that you can update your operating system also. You can change your operating system version also. So these are probably you won't be using now these things, but just they are available, I am telling you. Let me connect the real device. So let me kill the ADB. Okay, now if I do ADB shell, it directly put me into shell environment of this phone. Okay, so root@android is the environment set by this phone. So I am inside this phone, ADB shell. Let me get out of this. Let me do ADB devices. So it shows It doesn't shows emulator 5541. Now it shows 2008-04-11. So the manufacturer has set the name like this. So this device is connected. No AVD, nothing. You can see I am not running any AVD. So immediately if I do ADB shell, instead of hash prompt, I get a path username@localhost Android. So I can do lot of tweaking from here itself. What I want to show is I can kill some running apps. Suppose I think top is there. What does top do? Top will list the running processes and memory uses. So what I can see is, so it gives me the system properties, so CPU 1% used by KS, this top. So if you are a system designer or system engineer, what you will see, suppose your phone is getting hang after 10 minutes, you don't know what is happening. You will just go into the ADB shell, you will run top command and you will see which process is using CPU. Probably some process got zombie and it is in some deadlock and it is using all of your CPU time. So you can just kill that process from here. And later, of course, you can change your program and you can modify the bug, remove the bug. So this is how it works. So I can, even after my processes, I can, this control L works here, clear works, no. So again I have to ADB shell. There is another tool known as Android NDK. I will stop here with Android SDK. There are a lot of things to discuss. What is Android NDK? NDK is Native Development Kit. Suppose I have ls command, I have cp command already in my Android ADB shell. What if I want my custom command? Suppose a dot out, I created an a dot out with hello world program. Suppose I want to run similar program in my Android phone. So can I compile it my cross compiler and directly put it on Android with ARM cross compiler? If time permits, I can show you that. So I have a cross compiler installed for ARM versions. So that is, GCC, yeah. So I can run this command. This is a cross compiler program. This is not the CC command. CC is my default x86 compiler and this is my ARM Linux Android EA by GCC. Okay. If I compile hello.c using this cross compiler and if I execute that hello.c here, theoretically it should work. And if I compile it statically, that means it will not take the files from Bionic Libc, it will directly execute within itself because it has all the files. So where is my hello.c? I think it's probably here only. Yeah. So just give a static flag. It's created. What I want to do is file a.out default. I haven't provided hyphen o an output file name. So it says ELF 32-bit executable for ARM. And it's a statically linked, it's not dynamically linked. So it doesn't depend on Bionic Libc because whatever components required, it's already there. What I will do is ADB push a dot out to my /data. So what I did, I just compiled one source code using cross compiler and I put my binary inside some slash data folder. Slash data is user folder. Now I will go inside my phone and I will execute that a dot out and it should print hello or whatever, Srikant. ADB shell, I am inside the phone, cd slash data, okay, ls hyphen l a dot out. So H is there, hyphen H is not implemented in this version of LS. So the relevant information for us is this. So our file is there in slash data. I want to execute. How to execute? Dot slash it works. Why? Because I created a statically image, statically linked binary file. It uses how much memory? It uses around 33 KB. Let me try it here. What is the file size ls-lh of a dot out? It's around 332 KB. So, just to print Srikanth, I spent 332 KB of precious embedded memory, and in embedded world, memory is very important. So, is it recommended to do like this? Of course not. So, what I have to do? I have to use the system libc, that is Bionic libc, instead of my statically compiled program. So, for that I need a special kit that is known as NDK, Native Development Kit. I also downloaded that, and it is in document Android NDK, and it is not that easy that I will copy my hello.c here and I will just run some command, it will create a binary and it will run dynamically in Android. You have to do some changes, you have to write one make file. There are steps available in the default site. So, if you see Android NDK, is it visible? If you see Android NDK, you can download the NDK, you have the steps to follow, and there are examples also how to compile the hello dot program, hello dot c, and etcetera, etcetera. Is this clear? So, after this you have to download Eclipse IDE, you have to install ADT plugin. ADT plugin is a special plugin which will enable Eclipse to debug Android programs. It will have an inbuilt icon by which if you click, you can create an AVD. You understand AVD? The same AVD which we have created using Android command, virtual device, remember? So, in Eclipse what we will have, you can write your Java code, you can click a button, it will build it, it will create an APK, it will automatically send that APK to your AVD, and you can easily see your output of your program on the virtual device. If you have connected your real device, then also it will show on real device also. So, try on Eclipse if you are using anything on Android possibly, and it is very easy, of course, means it is not that difficult, but you must know the system level things also. That is why I introduced ADB shell and Android binary. Before you do something on real device, it is recommended to try it on emulator, though the final end product you should test it on real device 100 times. And never use rm-rf to just check whether permissions are there or not. Okay? Don't try to remove any directory if you are not sure inside your phone. Suppose I am here, I am in root@android, clear does not work. Okay. Let me clear the screen, ADB shell. So, I have files, I have root permission. What I can do? I can do ADB shell rm-rf/data. What it will do? If I have permissions properly, it will remove all my content of data folder. So, do not leave your system unattended if you are sitting somewhere in public place or in lab or somewhere with Android device connected in real mode. So, let me try what it happens exactly. Oh, F is not implemented. So, what I can do is I will try with hyphen R. F means force, it won't ask me. Failed for /data, device or resource busy. Unfortunately, it didn't remove. I forgot that I am running on real device. Actually, I was thinking that I was running on emulator, so I tried this command. If you would have remembered this, I was actually running from tablet. I never have been tested on this device. Anyway, I have backup ROM for this. I can reinstall later. See the point. So, not at all recommended. So, what I can do is I can type. You can see a display. I can just type reboot. So, my phone will be restart. So, let us see actually removed something or not. Anyway, that's all about today's presentation. Thanks for attending. Thank you, everyone.